there is a place in North Carolina dedicated to preserving the memory of legends. Located next door to a park in honor of one of the great legends of NASCAR, Dale Earnhardt. Telling the story of music as written, sung, and played by the best of the best from our state. Today, we'll visit the North Carolina Music Hall of Fame and meet one of its most famous members. On My Heart Will Always Be in Carolina. It has been quite a while, but finally the doors are open, and a man who himself is a Tar Heel music pioneer has taken the time to show us around. We were excited to be here in Kannapolis at a place to pay tribute to the music of North Carolina and the artists who have created it. Welcome to the program. I'm Ken Mann. Today we're in the North Carolina Music Hall of Fame Museum, and our special guest is Mr. Eddie Ray. Mr. Ray, it is so good to have you with us today.
Thank you.
Can I just call you Eddie?
Yes, please do.
Before we start talking about the organization and the museum, I think our viewers would really be interested in hearing a little bit about Mr. Eddie Ray. Eddie, as I understand it, you were raised in North Carolina, born in the mountains, started off at the bottom in the music industry and worked your way all the way to the top. Tell us about it.
Yes, I was born up in the Great Smoky Mountains, a little town called Franklin, North Carolina. And then I went to high school down in Laurinburg, North Carolina, a school called Laurinburg Institute. I came a few years after a great musician named Dizzy Gillespie. He graduated from Laurinburg Institute in Laurinburg, North Carolina. Shortly after high school, I eventually arrived in California, where I spent most of my adult life.
How about the music industry? How did you get started?
You know, it's a funny thing. On my way to California, I stopped in Milwaukee. And at that time, you know, Milwaukee was an industrial city. They had the big smokestacks and the foundries. And I was sent out by the employment agency for a job. And they sent me to a foundry. And I walked in there, and all these guys, you know, 6 feet four, huge guys. Here's this little guy weighing at most 125 pounds. And they told me, get out of here. This is not for you. I went back to the employment agency, and they sent me to Decca Record Distributing Company. And it was on North Clybourne Avenue in Milwaukee. And I got, that was my first job in the record business. I was a stock boy for Decca. I stayed there for about 3 or 4 months. It started getting cold. I saw pictures of beautiful sunny California. And the next thing I knew, I was on a train going to California. And I arrived in Los Angeles 2 days before Thanksgiving in 1945. I had intended to go back to school And there was a record company, an independent record company called Aladdin Records. They had a lot of R&B artists like Amos Milburn, Chicken Shack Boogie, and it was only about three blocks from LA City College. So I started there and I got a promotion. Instead of stock boy, I was a assistant shipping clerk. And the two owners were Leo and Eddie Messner. Leo Messner was a former college professor from City College in New York. And he saw that I was interested in going on to college, so he was encouraging me to go to school. He'd even tell me to take time off from work to do my studying. And his brother, Eddie Messner, was head of A&R. He knows I was interested in what is this record we're selling so many of. And so he would bring the artists by and he'd introduce them to me. Then he started taking me to concerts all over LA with the Aladdin artists, and finally started taking me to recording sessions where I would sit and watch how recordings were done. This is where I really became interested in the music business with Aladdin Records. I stayed there for 4 years, and after I graduated from LA City College, there was a new distributing company opened up called Central Record Sales Company that represented about 90% of all the independent record companies like Atlantic Records, who had a lot of big artists, the Clovers, Dot Records. We even had some country artists, you know, that we represented on the West Coast. And in a very short period of time, I started there in charge of inside sales, shipping and receiving, and then eventually I got involved also in record promotion and record sales. Then I became a purchaser. I would buy the records, so that gave me contact with the owners of these record companies, because I would call them. They would send me, I think they called them acetates during those days, of new releases like the Drifters, Clyde McFadden, Ruth Brown, all these big artists. And I would hound not only do the buying, but I would hound the local radio promotion. I'd take it to the radio stations and to the major retail stores. And during the 4 years I was there, I became known as having a good ear. I don't know why they thought I could pick hits, and then the major companies started wanting me to join them. While I was at Central Record Sales Company, I, with a partner in San Bernardino, California, we had opened up a record shop called Paradise Records. But we got together, we were putting songs together. I would write the lyrics and he would put the music. And we came up with a song that I said, this sounds like a hit to me. And I went and produced it myself, started a record company called R&B Records. My first record, a song called Hearts Made of Stone.
Yeah, I'd say that turned out to be a pretty good one, didn't it?
It turned out to be a good one. We didn't have enough funds to promote our record nationally, but the song was covered by Randy Wood on Dot Records by a group called the Fontaine Sisters, and it became number one in the country pop. And then it was covered by Red Foley in the country and got in the top records country. And then an R&B group called The Charms in Cincinnati recorded and became number one R&B. And later I had 32 different versions of the record, and it still sells 60 years later. I went to work on a national level as national sales and promotion manager for Imperial Records. And there I was pretty fortunate. I had a hit country artist named Slim Whitman. Hi. Remember Indian Love Call and all those? And I promoted those. I promoted Slim along with, we had a kid from New Orleans that was destined to be a superstar named Fats Domino. Oh. And then we picked up a kid from Hollywood. His dad and mom had a big hit TV show named Rick Nelson. We called him Ricky Nelson then. Ricky was 16. So I had some very good product to promote and sell nationally. And at this time, the so-called English invasion, the groups from England. And what happened, EMI was an English company that owned Capitol Records. So most of these English acts belonged to EMI. EMI gave Capitol, their subsidiary, first refusal rights for North America and South America for those artists. Capitol decided to start a new label called Tower Records, and they wanted someone who'd had experience working with independent distributors, first of all, and independent record producers, and was familiar with the type of records that the kids were buying, you know, these group records. And so they hired me as head of A&R for this Tower Records. The first thing I did, Ken, I went through the catalog and I noticed that they had released a record that sold nothing for them. But I knew that that artist was coming to America to be on Shindig and one of the other hot shows at that time, named Freddie and the Dreamers. So I picked that up and released it, and it was my first hit, number one hit. I'm telling you now, but Freddie and the Dreamers went number one. Then I picked up another independent, produced record in the United States by a group called the Standells that went number one. I picked up another one out of Seattle, Washington by Ian Whitcomb. It went number one. And the thing that I'm proudest of during my 5 years with Capitol is that there was a group making noise in England, and Capitol were getting ready to turn it down. It only had 2 weeks left on the option, and I listened to them, and I also found out what they were doing in Europe, and I signed them up. And I saved this group for Capitol Records called Pink Floyd.
No, boy.
Pink Floyd, you know, went on to be giants, you know. And the other thing that I'm proud of I did at Tower, a 17-year-old kid walked in my office one day without an appointment, and he didn't even have a demonstration record. And I asked him, what can I do? I mean, what do you want? And he says, I want a live audition. I said, no, I don't give live audition. For some reason or another, I did. And this guy, his name was Mike Curb.
Oh, boy.
And so Mike and I did a lot of things through soundtracks. Mike, with AIP Pictures, we did movie soundtracks that went to the kids. We did surfing records. We did motorcycle records. We did all kinds of records. But what it did, it created a relationship that lasts even to today. But what's strange about this, about 5-6 years later, I get a call from this kid and wanted me to come to work for him. He became president of MGM Records. And so I became senior vice president of A&R administration for MGM, so I worked with Mike for about 5 years.
And they had a lot of big artists too.
Oh yeah, the Osmonds, he did Candyman for Sammy Davis Jr., hit after hit. When I left MGM, I came to Memphis for 5 years, and I ran a label called High Records with Al Green, and you know they had several R&B artists. So when I was in Memphis, I started a vocational school called the Tennessee College of Recording Arts and Sciences. I was very interested in the commercial music education because so many of the artists and songwriters, especially in Memphis, I found even those who had written hit songs, they knew very little about the business. They didn't even know what BMI or ASCAP meant, you know, things of that nature in contract. So this is why I started that school. So in the meantime, Mike had become Lieutenant Governor of the State of California. He approached me about getting involved in some way in commercial music education. And through him, I've started also becoming more active in politics. And he introduced me to who became President Reagan. I met President Reagan through Mike Kirk. And afterwards, after he became president, there was a tribunal, copyright tribunal in Washington. There was a vacancy. And for the first time, Mr. Reagan felt that someone should be on that agency that was from the industry, that had practical experience in copyrights and this business. And so he appointed me because I was the first non-lawyer, and, you know, on that agency. And for 4 years, I was the chairman of the agency. And then I got the call from the kid again in North Carolina, Mike Kerb, who was in Kannapolis. He has a motorsports here in Kannapolis. And he was asking me, why doesn't North Carolina have a Music Hall of Fame with all the artists that came from? So we did some research. We found out that they did have a North Carolina Music Hall of Fame. We got in touch with people. What had happened? This North Carolina Music Hall of Fame was incorporated by a gentleman named Doug Croft, who is the president of the Chamber of Commerce, still is, in Thomasville. They had started it in the early 90s. I think it's 1994. They had one induction, and the first 8 members were inducted in Thomasville. They weren't able to find a place to house the memorabilia that they had obtained, and it became inactive. We got in touch with them, and Mike Kerb Family Foundation formed a partnership. Mike got a building in Kannapolis, and it was a former jailhouse, an old jailhouse. The cells are still downstairs, Ken. Be nice. And we remodeled it into a very beautiful little museum, and he gave it to the Hall of Fame on a 10-year lease for no money, and it's provided operating capital to get it started, and that's where we are today.
When you walk through the door, you'll feel the beat of the music. And here's just a little of what you'll find in the North Carolina Music Hall of Fame.
In the world of country music, North Carolina has been well represented by people like Randy Travis from Marshfield, Ronnie Millsap, Donna Fargo, and Don Schlitz.
Don is from Durham. He wrote number one songs like The Gambler and Forever and Ever Amen. Donna Fargo from Mount Airy has recorded some of the great songs like Funny Face and The Happiest Girl in the Whole USA. Ronnie Millsap from Robbinsville, North Carolina, has crossed over onto the pop charts and gospel music charts.
When it comes to R&B, some of the best have their roots in North Carolina. The chairman of the board, Maurice Williams and the Zodiacs, Archie Bell, Roberta Flack, and Billy Scott.
He recorded some of his big hits on the Moody Brothers Le Mans Records label from Charlotte. We all remember "The First Time Ever I Saw Your Face" by Roberta Flack from Asheville was number one. Archie Bell from Archie Bell and the Drells spent a lot of time in North Carolina and sang Tighten Up to fans around the world. Maurice Williams of Maurice Williams and the Zodiacs lives in Charlotte, and he's still out there today singing Little Darling and Stay.
When it comes to bluegrass, it doesn't get any better than North Carolina's Earl Scruggs and Curly Sackler.
Curly is from China Grove. He branded bluegrass music with his unique style of playing. And he picked with some of the best, making him a legend in his own time. Who could forget Foggy Mountain Breakdown, or the theme song from the Beverly Hillbillies, with Earl Scruggs from Flint Hill playing the banjo.
From the world of jazz, there's Thelonious Monk and John Coltrane.
John was from Hamlet, and Thelonious was born in Rocky Mount. They carried their music around the world. No one has ever played it any better.
When it comes to opera, there's Victoria Livengood.
A metropolitan opera star, Victoria was from Thomasville, and she has never forgotten her roots, returning to perform for family, friends, and fans in North Carolina.
The eastern part of the state is well represented in the North Carolina Music Hall of Fame by actor, singer, and musician Andy Griffith.
Andy's career has included both comedy records and gospel music. He was born in Mount Airy and made his home in later years in Manteo, North Carolina. And most all will agree, he's one of the best-known artists from the Tar Heel State.
Although they may not have been born in North Carolina or have roots in the Tar Heel State, there are many artists from around the nation who are now connected to the North Carolina Music Hall of Fame because of member Mike Curb.
Mike Curb has a love for North Carolina that goes beyond words. We've learned that his contributions have made this wonderful museum possible, something all of us can be very proud of. He continues to be a true leader in the music industry. Curb recording artist Rodney Atkins has played all over North Carolina, including the State Fair. Without a doubt, Mike Curb has touched the careers of many of your favorite singers, songwriters, and musicians. The induction ceremony for the North Carolina Music Hall of Fame is held every October in Kannapolis and features great food and fellowship. But the stars of the show are the inductees. Some of the other members of the North Carolina Music Hall of Fame include Ben E. King, Nina Simone, James Taylor, George Hamilton IV, Arthur Smith, Don Gibson, and Les Brown, just to name a few.
Well, thank you so much for spending a few minutes with us and sharing with us about your background and the history of the museum and where it is today. And hopefully our viewers will want to come and visit and become a part of the program.
Thank you, Ken.
Thank you again. And thank you so much for watching. I hope you'll join us again next time for more people, places, and things. Well, my heart will always be in Carolina. I'm Ken Mann. May God bless you richly. My heart.